Spirit. Father, we thank you right now for your wisdom, your revelation. Oh, I declare that it flows freely, unhindered, uninterrupted by any satanic or demonic force. God, thank you for this opportunity to minister to these, your precious sheep. Speak to my vocal cords and think through my mind, none of me and all of you. God, I decrease so that the word of God and your presence may increase into the lives of these, your people. Now, Father, I thank you for the children's ministry and the youth ministry. And I declare they are anointed, appointed, and approved to minister to our seed. The next generation will be mighty in this earth. And God, I thank you for your presence. I thank you for the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you have the liberty to move up and down every aisle, in and out of every row. Oh, touch us and deliver us, God. Thank you, Lord. I declare all ears are anointed to hear the word of God. All ears are anointed to hear your voice. And all hearts are good ground to receive from the word of God. We give you all the honor, all the glory, and all of the praise. And it's in Jesus' name. And XL Church said, amen. Glory to God. Go ahead and find you two or three people. Love on them the XL way. Let them know they're special to God and special to us. Glory to God. If you need a Bible, slip your hands up. Greetings, our church. How are you guys doing? Slip your hands up and the ushers can get you one. God forbid we look at scripture as we go. We want you to see it for yourself. I tell you what, I'm so glad I'm cut from that cloth to look at scripture, because I just couldn't make it in a church where we're just, nothing wrong with it, but just hooping and hollering and screaming. And I don't see what you're even talking about. My diminishing intent to follow God will begin to taper. And it's like, man, show me something. I'm struggling at home. You got to show me something about what you're talking about. So make sure you get a Bible. Well, make sure your phone is charged up and your iPad is charged up. God forbid you open that iPad and you got about 8% battery on that thing. God almighty. I don't know what's worse, missing God or not charging your phone. Man. Get mad at everybody, mad at your spouse, mad at this man. Hey. Plug that thing up yourself. Ain't right, Pastor? Get you a routine life. We're in our financial empowerment month. And what's my son's journal doing in my Bible? You want me to read something? I'm honored to God. I'm not going to open it up. I'm not going to open it up. Just hold it for him there. First of all, I want to thank Elder Lamont for filling in Wednesday night. I mean, tell ya. Just hop right in there and float. Just hop right in there and float. I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. You know, if you're not developing people and discipling people, what are we doing as believers? You know, don't be like Saul. When David went out and did what he did, man, the people were shouting this, that, and the other. Man, Saul wanted to kill the guy because he got more applause than him. No way. Lower your shoulder, lift people up. You take them to the top, which so I thank God for Elder Lamont. Hallelujah. Shoot. We've been talking about money. And we haven't even got to what I'm gonna teach on in the coming weeks, which is the other 90%. How to live off of that and how to grow that and how to prosper in that legitimately and authentically. And not follow the crowd of it's going good verbally. No. It's going good because I can tangibly touch my progress, and it's going good because I honor God with my finances. It's going good because I'm rich towards other people, and we as a people know that about us, and we know that we do these things and we operate in these principles that's gonna bring us prosperity, that's gonna honor God, that's gonna bring joy to God's heart. We know that we do these things, and we said last week, I don't want to be a church that we run around and touch 10 people and tell them we're going to be a millionaire tomorrow and nobody is prospering where they are. I want to be a church where you rejoice when you get the Kia. I want to be a church where you rejoice when you get the 2-bedroom condo. I want to be a church where you rejoice when you get out of debt. I want to be a church where you rejoice when you pay off your student loans. I want to be a church that we rejoice when you get your nursing degree or whatever it is. What? You're excelling in life, excelling in God, and you're doing it legitimately. Not pie in the sky. Not, you know, God, come on. None of that kind of stuff. It's I am prospering so fanatically, all I can do is come into the house of God and give thanks to him and honor him. Because if God takes pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, I take pleasure in reciprocating my thankness back to him. So we're talking about this money, and we've talked about the allure of mammon. What is the allure of mammon? Mammon has an evil tone to it. God says you can't serve God and mammon. You can't serve God and mammon. And what he's saying is, make sure money's not your God. Make sure your countenance and your disposition doesn't rise and fall and bell curve with how much money you have in the bank or how much money you don't have in the bank, or did you get the job, did you get the promotion? Make sure your countenance does not rise and fall with the amount of money you have. Why? Because it talks about in the New Testament, godliness and contentment is great gain. And Paul mastered contentment. He said, whatsoever state I'm in. It doesn't matter. I know the baseline.
That's right. That's right.
So we said, stay away from the allure of mammon because it has an evil influence to it. It has an evil tone to it. And you have to make sure in your individual spirit, in your union, in your household, that the celebrated mindset is this right here, honoring God, financially speaking. You find yourself getting grudgingly towards God. And most of the time, this doesn't happen when people don't have money. Because when people don't have money, all they have is, man, I just got to believe God. When I was in Nigeria, I said, man, what are those people doing right there? He said, oh, they're walking the service. I said, the service? I said, dirt road, they're standing there with a basket on their head, 4 kids with a basket. They're walking the service? Yeah. I said, how many miles are they walking the service? About 5 or 6. I said, wow. I said, man, alive. He said, you see those guys? You see how the ladies walking, the guys are behind them? I said, yeah, I see that. They're to keep the militia from raping the little babies and the ladies. I said, now walking to church? Here's what he said. It's all they got. See, in the Western culture, it's all we have is our God, and we trust our God. We put our lives on the line every single Sunday, what these people were doing, to get to church. And I said, well, what happens? He said, well, he said, a lot of them lose their husbands because, hey, these guys bust in the house and say, deny God. Oh, you're not going to deny God? Bring his kids out here. Sit right here. Where's your wife? Sit right here. Deny God. You're the head of this family? Deny God. No, I'm not going to deny God. Kneel. And the machete comes out. And guess what? We're going to behead you. That is what was happening in the church that we were in, visiting, preaching in. What was it? It's a group of people who say, you know what? All I have is God. Sometimes the worst things, the most detrimental things sometimes to our thankfulness and worship towards God is comfort. I'm comfortable, so I really don't need you right now, God. I'm comfortable. Money is good. Job is good. Promotions are good. I really don't need you right now. No, you're comfortable. But when you realize, oh, I got everything I need, and the only way I got it was God provided it for me. He provided the oxygen in my lungs, the blood in my veins for me to get it. You know what? All I can do is come in the house of God and be thankful towards him. But when that increase comes, things begin to go well. We begin to store for ourselves, our future selves. But we begin to forget the God who gave us the power to get it. And Minister Jason said it. He said, don't trust that stuff. So don't let it, what we're saying, don't let money begin to store up and you stop leaning on God. The only way I know I'm still trusting God is with my money. You want to know if you're anchoring your trust in God? This green stuff, it'll let you know. Do I trust you with this, God? I trust you with my wife, my kids. I trust you, but do I trust you with this? And we're going to see in the scripture today where Paul said, listen, just set aside something before you even get to church for God. Just set it aside because we provided for you this week, this, that, and the other. Just give us 10, you take the 90, and you go into Disney World. Some people say, nope, I want the 100%. And some people say, I've struggled on the 100% all my life. There's no way I can make it on 90. That's a lie from the pit of hell. That's a lie from the pit of hell. I'm here to tell you, at $20,000 a year, on Social Security, on disability, I'm here to tell you God can still take you from glory to glory, but you must anchor your trust in God. And we said earlier in the series, if you want to know anything about anybody, look at them when they have the most and look at them when they have the least. How do they respond to God? How do they respond to him? Man, I'm making more money than I ever made. How are you responding to God with that? That tells me everything about you and how you see money. Oh, my God, I lost my job. I'm down to $100 in my bank account, this, that, and the other. How are you going to respond to God Sunday? Bring him a nickel. Do something to show. I still trust you. I know you got me. Because if truth be told, people who are at the top of their game right now, I'm talking at the top of their game. Money comes in, honor God. Money comes in, honor God. This lady over here, take care of this person, rent, honor, buy these tithes. People who are at the top of their game, they will tell you, listen, I've been without before. And I still gave. Amen. I have such a thankfulness for what God has brought me out of. And such a tender heart towards those who are going through transition in life. When I see they need $200, I don't say, well, you need to get your college degree to get some money. No, why? We've been there. I don't say, well, my God, I mean, go to the dollar store and get you $20. I mean, you can go get some ramen noodles and all that kind of stuff. Yep, 1,500 milligrams of sodium. And they're going to survive off of that for 30 days when you're sitting there. Watch this. When we're sitting there with extra.
Come on. Come on.
They say, here, $50. Go to Publix and get some healthy food for those kids or whatever it is. Yeah, $50 will last them a month. $50 may last them 2 days. Sometimes you got to re-back up and go, you good to go? Are you guys okay? Why? We're sitting here with extra that God has blessed us with. So as we parlay into this second half of this series, as we parlayed into it, we began to talk about generous people. What it means to be generous with an open hand. And the Bible says we should have liberal souls. And those liberal souls shall be made fat. Fat is synonymous with extra. Prosperous. What's a liberal soul? Your hand is always wide open. To give and to receive. A lot of times in churches, we're very radical about calling things in. And we should be. Believing God to receive. And we should be. We should do that. Believing God for the promotion. And we should do that. Believing God for the scholarship. And we should do that. Believing God for the job. And we should do that. But we fall short when it comes to reciprocating back to God.
Come on.
We're not that radical when it comes to releasing back portion. But I call in that blessing now. I speak to that debt now. I call that car in now. God, I need this job now. I'll do that. What about your reciprocation when he does that for you? Are you just as fanatical or more fanatical to say, thank you, Lord?
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. So generous people, we're going to talk about their traits. You know, a generous person, this is not a trait, but they're not stingy. A generous person is not nervous about money. They understand God owns it all. Cattle on a thousand hills. They understand God owns it all, and all they do is manage it. They also understand, like Minister Jason talked about, I think it's Proverbs 23, verse 7, or verse 5, somewhere over there, where they understand that, listen, I know it's going good, but I still don't trust this stuff. I still don't trust this stuff. Why? Because the Bible tells me it will grow wings and fly away.
Amen.
I don't trust it. And we talked about being generous. We said, don't confuse the good life with the Zoe life. See, good life is, oh, my God, man, we got this, we got that, we got the job, we got some money and savings, we got a house. Oh, it's good. What's your attitude towards God, financially speaking now? Oh, I pull back on that. Oh, it's good, huh? Life is that. So life is so good, that you're not releasing towards God, it's not good, sir. You're in control of your life, and that's not good. Generous people, open hand. Why? Psalms 23, it says, God takes pleasure. Stop right there. God takes pleasure. In what? Things going bad for me? In the prosperity. Things going well for his servant. You have to park your faith right there. Park it right there. God takes pleasure in me getting this job. God takes pleasure in me getting this scholarship. God takes pleasure in me as a single mom. I understand I can't stress my diploma from the age 18 into 30. He takes pleasure in me getting this nursing program. Why? I'm going to lift my income up to match the demand of my family. And God takes pleasure in that. Well, sweetheart, I tell you, you're going to miss two services on every month Wednesday now. And I don't think God's going to be too kind of that now. Stop that religion.
Come on.
Let the single mom go get that certificate. You got one empty chair on Wednesday. So what? She's getting her degree. She's lifting her lifestyle to meet the earthly demands of her family. And God takes pleasure in the prosperity of that, of her. And guess what? She can catch the replay. But don't go. The preachers are going to shame and guilt folks into, man, what was you at Sunday? I'm trying to get my real estate license. God doesn't like that. That is a lie. From the pit of hell, you are insecure as a preacher. You are insecure as a pastor. If you are guilt tripping your people from missing a Wednesday night service because they're in college, community college, or in a program trying to lift their lives.
Amen.
Not an Excel church. No way. Why? We want you to prosper in God, prosper in life. And God forbid, sometimes you got to make moves. If you got $3,000 worth of bills and only $2,500 is coming in, you better stick a Jimmy John sign on top of that car. You to get that other $500, babysit, something. But to go 12 months times $500 and get $6,000 in the hole, and all you got to do is on a math.
Come on.
Now I need a miracle from God every month. Matter of fact, I don't even pay my rent on. I pay my rent in the grace period. How much is your rent? $1,000.55. I thought it was $900. Oh, the late fee. I already got that calculated in. No way. No more. What am I saying? God takes pleasure in you. Watch this. Lifting your life.
Come on.
Lifting it up. Now it's on you when you lift it if you forget him or not. It's on you when you begin to lift it, if you go back to replay or not. It's on you when you lift it, if you're still drawing closer to him and he's drawing closer to you. That's on you. But as a church, as a pastor, I'm not going to call you up and ask you, what was you at Wednesday? Number one, it's none of my business. Number two, if you're in a nursing program, get your degree and get that $65,000 a year. Go ahead and get it. I'm trying to tell you. Traits of generous people, what we're going to talk about today. Before we get into that, I want you to ask yourself this question. You can write this in your notes. Am I satisfied financially? Now remember, remember, it's not a trick question, but remember, Paul said, look, godliness and contentment is great gain. Am I satisfied financially? Now, let me give you two answers. You need to say, spiritually speaking, I believe God will take care of me. I have all my trust in God. Naturally speaking, I am tired of seeing NSFs in my bank account. I am tired of paying in the grace period. I am tired of paying 15% interest. I am tired of stressing out about money. But what would it take to really, not you become the God, but what would it take mathematically to meet that demand every 30 days? About an extra $250. Get the Jimmy John sign.
Come on.
Get the Pizza Hut sign. Come on. Go to Sam's and get part-time inventory at night, young man. Stocking shelves part. To go ahead and get that money. And magically, the stress, the shame, the robbing people to pay Paul, the finagling around. Buddy of mine, James Little, said, he said, look, man, I was just so tired of doing what he called the financial shuffle. Just shuffling stuff around to make it real. He said, man, I just got so deep in the pathway. He said, I just got so tired of that. And truth be told, what he was saying was, I'm not satisfied financially speaking. I love God. I give to God, this, that, and the other. But somehow or another, me and math don't have a good relationship. What is that? It's in your notes. It's hard to manipulate math. It's hard to manipulate math. Can't do it. It's just hard to do it. And here's the thing about math. Lack doesn't hit you day one. Shuffling around. Lack doesn't hit us day two. Lack doesn't hit us day three. Month three. Here's what lack does. Lack says you're about 400 short every month. Just keep shuffling. Throw a little bit on the credit card here. And there's times when you got to use a credit card, you lose your job, you got to float the bank's money to make sure your lifestyle go. I mean, make sure you have your necessities met. Guess what? You got to do that. But it says, keep ignoring me. Just keep doing that. 400 times 12, $4,800, year one. Keep ignoring me. 400 times 24, $9,600, year two. Yeah, just keep on norming. $14,400, year three in the hole. Within that $14,400, I tell you what, some mortgages are behind, some cars have been lost, or, you know, a guy told me one time, I said, hey, man, I didn't know you had three storage units. He said, yeah, two of my cars in the storage unit. I said, two of your cars? I said, what do you mean two of your cars in the storage unit? Yeah, man, I got behind on some stuff. I had to hide the cars from the repo, from the snatch man. And watch this. God is taking care of me. No, you're lying. You need to get that car detailed, fill it up with gas, write a letter. It's just very simple. It's a volunteer repossession. Write a letter, drive it up there, give it to him. But no, you're not going to do that. You're going to, watch this, you're going to pay for a storage unit, two of them, to hide a car you've already lost. What was he doing? Trying to manipulate math. Can't do it. Come on. Can God make a way? Yes. Can God take care of us? Yes. Can God stretch our gas? Yes. Can God stretch $100 into the 125? Yes, he can. But at some point, we have to disengage from opiateness taking place. What is that? I'm just numb to any kind of dreams. I'm numb to any kind of goal. I'm numb to any kind of things going well. I've reached a point in my life where I don't expect God to do anything in my life. I spend my time manipulating math every 30 days, and I sweat a little bit, and the pressure comes off. I send my money towards the greatest point of pressure every month. We're about to cut you off. Okay, send $200 over there. We're about to come get your car. Hey, it's like you stomp this spark out, and while you're stomping that one financially, another one's coming up. Man, I got a late fee over here. Oh, gosh. Oh, my God. The kids might get put out of private school. Let me go over here. And it's like, my Lord. What is it? Money has let you down. God will take care of us, but we got to honor that math, man. I didn't say honor money. I said honor math. Are you still out there? So we're still in our financial empowerment month. You know, which one do we want? Do we want this? Or do we want this? Can anybody tell us what we want? Left or right? Over here, right? You want that multiplication. See, this is overtime. This is trying to solve a spiritual problem with overtime. Trying to solve a spiritual problem, financially speaking, with more jobs, more contracts, but you're not honoring God. And you keep trying to, See, I used to be in sales, and I knew, man, I hit $10,000 and brag about it, this, that, and the other. Oh, man, remember that month? Oh, my God, $20,000. And man alive, what you don't acknowledge is, well, the last 3 months, you was at $500. So you really didn't make $20,000. You take that 20 divided by 3, that's what you really made. And that's $20,000, let alone you make $5,000 every 90 days in sales. At some point, you got to go, wait a minute now. I didn't make five. I made about 1333 or something like that. And that's called, that's addition. That's trying to solve a spiritual financial problem through addition, overtime, five jobs, this, that, and the other. And Ecclesiastes says, when goods increase, those that eat them, they increase their appetite. So what they're trying to do here is finance a bottomless pit and their lives never move forward. 40, 50, 60, 70, 80 hours a week, but they don't understand the financial acumen. It's not there yet. But when you get over here, you say, you know what? The greatest economy out there is God's economy. So I made $1,000. Man, worst case scenario, I'm cutting 100 off of it. I'm going to store it up in heaven. Why? He's the great multiplier. I made $1,000. I'm going to cut 100 off of it. I'm going to put it into my 401k or some kind of investment, Roth IRA. Why? Because the market is all about multiplication. Amen. Why? Because the market will work overtime 24/7 for me. So the greatest employee I'm going to have is going to be my money. I'm going to send it to work. And I don't want to go to work and add. I want to go to work and multiply. That's why I'm going to give vertically to God. I'm going to put it in some kind of compounding multiplication system in this earth that God gave the man the wisdom to put in here. I'm going to do that. And when you are generous, you have no problem cutting him off 10, paying yourself something, and then finding somebody else and so into their line. But when you are living off 100% of your income, and somebody says, hey, Johnny needs $200. Here's what the family says. I'm barely making it myself. I tell you what he needs to do. Get a job himself. We're barely paying bills over here. How in the world? And you know what? You are deadly accurate. How are you going to help anybody else be a blessing to anybody else, and you're living off 100% of your income? Can't do it. Can't do it. Can't do it. Can't do it. See, what you want is, there's a nephew of yours or a cousin of yours somewhere that the parents are going through, single mom, just really can't make it, and they're just saying to themselves, I'm giving it all I got. The streets are calling me. I mean, I can get some quick money. I don't want to do that. And all he's saying is, I just need 200 bucks for books. I just need 200 bucks for books. And here you are sitting with extra and not even going to God and say, hey, I have extra. Where would you have me to give it? Come on. Where? Oh, Darrell, you think you need some? And you call your little nephew up, your little cousin up. Hey, I don't know if, you know, we wanted to be a blessing to you. We wanted to give you this, and this. And he's silent on the phone. Hey, you still there? Yeah, I'm still here. What's up? We want to do this for you. And he's silent. And he finally tells you, I'm so glad you called. Why? I was going to go in the store and get my $200. What store? I was going to go get the money. I was going to get the money. And what is this? God is moving on your heart. Watch this. To offset the lack of somebody else. That's a generous person.
Amen.
That's a generous person. Let's get to the scripture here. Glory to God. Okay. As I was preparing for this message this week, all week, 2 weeks ago, I said, Derek, what good is our relationship? He said, Derek, what good is our relationship if you don't have something that constantly symbolizes your trust in me, your thankfulness for who I am in your life? What good is our relationship if you don't have something that constantly symbolizes your trust in me and your thankfulness for who I am in your life? And here's what I said. I said, well, God, my giving to others, the kingdom work, my church, is that symbol of trust. And here's what he said. You answered right. Because outside of 99.9% of the things, that money controls our countenance. It gauges our trust. If you don't believe it, well, let me throw another one in. A lost cell phone. You get up from the thing, get up from the restaurant, you walk into the car, boy, that meal was so great. Oh, glory to God. Man, it was just awesome. Yeah, man, it's 10th anniversary. God is just so good to us. And your wife go, you go, what is it? I think I left my phone. Matt, you disengaged from that conversation anniversary. Before you even get into your mind, has raised, somebody's got that, and I got our anniversary pictures in there, and we're going to go, I'm going to lose my kids. I mean, your mind is taking off. So outside the cell phone, having us. Boy, you lose that thing will, you just go home. Did you find it yet? No, I didn't find it yet. Let me call the restaurant. You still on hold? Yeah, I'm on hold. I don't care if I got to wait 45 minutes. I got to find out. I wonder if that waitress got that phone. 9 times out of 10, she got it unlocked. Oh, my God, it went right to voicemail. Man, you, and now you're just like, oh, man, they know they got it. But that phone, it can, I know for me, I got my phone, and I'm watching her. Because I know, okay, we're going through security. Phone, boarding pass, all right, belts off. I'm like, okay. All right, she got it in there, iPad in there. Where's your phone at? Okay. Here come your thing. I got your phone for you. Because that phone, just like mammon, man, it control a lot of stuff. It control a lot of stuff. So God says, what in your life symbolizes your trust for me, Derek? I said, God, I come pray with you every day. I mean, my God, I'm honoring my parents. I'm honoring my wife. I'm honoring my, I know that, but why did he say you can't serve? And he compared it to money because it's right there with God. It is God in some people's lives. He said, let me tell you what's right next to my name in most people's lives, money, and they serve it. Many people fear not having enough at retirement. I said this last week. To the point they lose sight of storing up in heaven. Man, ain't gonna have enough for retirement. Cut back on that tithe. Cut back on giving to God and make sure we're gonna have enough for retirement. So, like Mr. Jason said, so you're gonna put your trust in that? That's the route you're gonna take? Go for it. You feel good? You feel secure? Go for it. Retirement has gotten such a fear-based root in people now. It's trying to replace God's economy taking care of us. Do I believe in investing? Yes. Do I believe in investing in a Roth IRA? Yes. Do I believe in, if they're going to match your 401k, that's free money? Get it. I believe in all of that. But at the end of the day, I don't believe in that over God's economy. People work all their lives, and watch this, and fear the rewards of it. Think about that. Think about how mammon wants to control us. Are you going to control me while I'm working? Now I got 30 years at the corporation, and now you're saying, hey, I'm just saying, lose 5% of me, you're going to be in trouble. Now you're still trying to control me at retirement? Come on. No way. No way do we want mammon controlling us from the womb to the doggone tomb. So how do you do it? You cut it off the top. You cut it off the top like this. Minister Jason, I got my own money today. Seen Amanda look at that 20 coming back to you. I'm going to come out here with my own money today. How do you do it? Okay, so here we are. My granddaddy used to do. You take that thumb and just run it down the middle. Now, he used to lick the hand. Ain't licking no hand. But God says, hey, on that job, Friday, you sold your hours to make dollars. Man, you honored me, this, that, and the other. I gave you 100. Paul says, hey, before you get to church on Friday, when that direct deposit hit, take 10, set it aside. Then I want you to think about your future self. Take 10 more and put it towards the 65-year-old you. Then, you have $80 now, and out of that 80, you're going to fund your lifestyle, and you're going to think about others. So you didn't make $100 that week because you're already pre-programmed to be generous. You know, I got 80 for my food and my sustenance this week. Is everybody with me? That's week one. Week two or year two. Man, I'm dropping. Close your eyes, sweetheart. Close your eyes. I thought I'd just seen you tell Brother Jim to pan in on that. I don't know. If pan in on that for me, Brother Jim. So, okay, I'm losing track of you. You make me nervous. So here's the 100. Year two, God said, look, I take pleasure in the prosperity of my servants. And so year two, that Friday, is 200 now. So, man, serving God, giving to God, God gave me the power to get wealth, this, that, and the other. Man, me and giving it to my bosom, this, that, and the other. Now, here's what generous people do. They already know. I'm already set to be generous. So they know. Take 20 off of that. What happened? That tithe on increase now. Here's what people who trust money do. My tithe has gotten bigger? Wait a minute. Man, I'm at 10 grand a month. That tithe is $1,000 a month now? It's 1,000. Yeah, God took you from 500 to 5,000 to 10,000. Yeah, but man, it was easy. Watch this. It was easy to get that 5. It's harder to give that 10. You have no revelation of what God is doing in your life. So they say, here's what they say. Show me in the New Testament word. Oh, man, now we're, what's happening? Well, just show me in the word where it says, you know, I'm just trying to figure out. Now you want to debate about it? And God is increasing you? What's happening? Your heart is getting hard towards God concerning money. And God is like, I told you not to forget me, man. Now I'm not going to curse you. You're not going to lose your house. You didn't tithe that month. You're not cursed. You're still going to heaven. But my God, know this. He who sows in this lifetime will reap in this lifetime. Know that now. You pulling back, don't dismantle my reward system in your life. So if you sow bountifully, you're going to reap bountifully. You sow sparingly, you're going to reap sparingly. See, when I see this right here, I go, wait a minute. 2 years, 100% increase. Man, what is 5 years going to look like?
Come on. Yeah.
Girl, look, we ain't doing 10 no more. Do 20. Well, I'm not trying to buy God. I'm just saying, you're so good to me. Promotion. Oh, my God, I got a bachelor's degree. It required a master's degree to get a position. They gave it to me anyway and gave me 25% or more than the other guy that had the last position. Da, 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 da. Man, God, you're blowing my mind. I don't care what they say. I am generous towards your economy because you are causing me to triumph.
Yeah, come on.
You understand what I'm saying? But here's what I used to do when tithing offering came around. Great are you, Lord. It's your grace, your love. Here come that offering basket. Where the offering basket? Oh, they didn't talk about it. Your grace. Let me see that basket. Your love as he poured out our grace. Depend on our hands in your grace. In your love as he poured you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. It's your grace.
And you know what? And you put $5.
Pastor, you got the $5. I know you seen it.
And you put $5. See, that's not a widow's mite because you're increased. The widow gave out of her substance, out of her last. But he said, the rich men, they ain't missed it. They ain't missed it. They made a million, gave 1,000. Man, you ain't done nothing. You ain't missed nothing. So what are we saying? You got to be generous. What's a generous person do?
It's your grace and your love.
See, I used to try to pull it out strategically. Man, I know when I rolled that money up, I had about 10 20s on top. I think I got 2 ones in the middle somewhere. And my personality, you can ask my wife, everybody's looking at me. Derek, go ahead and return it to the counter. Man, people are going to think I'm just difficult. Ain't nobody looking at you, Derek. I'm just on the plane. Derek, go ahead and use the restroom. Nah, I don't want to disturb nobody. People are going to be like, what is he doing? Won't he sit his tail down? And I ain't been up, but my personality just feels like, man, everybody's monitoring me. So, it's your grace. It's your love.
Here's what a generous person do.
As we pour out our hand and pour out our hand in your grace.
And here's what they're saying. Get me back to Monday, baby. I'm going to go out here and I'm going to take from them. And I'm going to come back into the house of God. And I'm going to say, God, you have been good to me.
It's your grace and your love as we pour out our
hey, man alive. I said, go ahead and finish that example real time. Release that money. I don't believe in emotionally giving. No, I'm just. Hey, I want to read this to you. Our God is a running over God. He doesn't want you to just have barely enough to meet your own needs. God wants you to be so blessed that when other people get around you, watch what it does. It overflows onto them. It overflows into your nephew's life. Nephew's trying to figure out, how am I going to get tennis shoes for school? Your niece trying to figure out, a single mom trying to figure out, how am I going to get books, paper, shoes, for this and the other? And you're sitting there with extra. So I'll tell you how you're going to do it. With this $500 I'm going to give you. Now, if you come to know him to take the five and go to Dillard's, you just need to go to Target first, get the two book bags. What size shoe they wear? Okay, I got the size. I got the shoes. Book bag, what kind of, Spider-Man? Okay, I got that. Batman, I got all the book bags. I got all that. And here you go. Why? Because I hand you this five. It may not make it to little Johnny here. So there are situations where you have to not have an evil eye like Mr. Jason talked about, but you got to be, you're trying to bless. You're trying to offset the lack. You just got to know the person that you're dealing with here. And a lot of us got relatives. We just know. We just know. We won't make it to Johnny. So let me go ahead and get it for Johnny myself. So it should be overflowing into the lives of others. What do I mean overflowing into the lives of others? When was the last time you picked up the whole tab? See, I'm not going to sit around Magianos with people excelling in life, excelling in God, money is right, that we work with in pathways, and here we are passing a $300 bill around to divide the ticket up and spend 30 minutes and stress the waitress out, stress the waiter out, and dig it in pockets to get pennies and dollars. No way. Here's what you do. Small check to me, please. Why? I have extra. So put your little cards up, put your little money up. Because here's a natural reaction when somebody say, I got the whole check. Hey, I thought I was about to. You weren't about to. Man, I was about to. You weren't about to. You weren't about to do nothing. I'm not going to sit here and go around circling this circle, pulling out calculators and all that. Just go ahead and take the whole tab. Why? Because God has been so good to us, it's overflowing into the lives of those who went out to have dinner with you. Do you hear what I'm saying? Man, I cannot get to this doggone thing. In the same way that you as a parent, me as a parent, love to see our children doing well and excelling, God wants us to do the same thing. He sees us the same way. He wants you to do well and excel in every area of your life. And we said earlier, he takes pleasure in prospering you. Somebody say me. A lot of times we say, you know what? God is good, but not to me. Debts can be canceled, but not mine. That 25% raise you talked about, that can happen to somebody else, but not me. No way. He wants to prosper you. They can get a house. I can't. They can rebuild their credit. I can't. That's a lie from the pit of hell. But in order for us to receive this, in your notes, receive what? God's desire to prosper us. We got to make room for that thought in our thinking. We have to make room for that thought. What thought? God wants to prosper me in our thinking. You have to know that God is not looking to get things from you. In other words, he's not looking to break you down. He's not looking to get your money and you go bankrupt. He's looking to say, you know what? I want to partner with you. And the way we're going to partner is when you sow, you reap.
I invented seed time and harvest time. So when you see the grass clothing the fields, you see it green sometimes, you see it dormant. And when it's dormant, I send the rain to take care of that grass. That's the system we're in. So it's all around us how God keeps things green and flourishing. He says, you know what? You grew, I rain. You're about to die, you're dormant, I rain down on you. And guess what? My economy, you come back green and lush. This right here is the same way. Never let nobody convince you that God only wants from you and he doesn't want to get anything to you. That is a lie. We serve an awesome God. A God who wants to bless us. A God who wants to prosper us. My Lord. Got to change your thinking. 24 minutes. Here's what I want you to do. Begin to thank God in advance. Begin to thank God in advance for where you want to be. If you want to be debt free, so God, I thank you right now that I'm debt free. God, I can see myself rejoicing in my family, in my family room, in my living room, whatever it is, when that debt's paid off or when it's canceled, I can see myself. So I thank you in advance for what you're going to do in my life. God, I thank you in advance for these student loans. I just declare in the name of Jesus. You know, they got bills out now and all these laws being passed. I declare in the name of Jesus, my little name, my little soul should get wrapped up in this thing. And my student loans are canceled in the name of Jesus. And I thank you in advance for that, God. Oh, boy, that sounds a little radical. Sometimes you got to be a little radical. You're not gonna lose 50 pounds walking on 1.5 on a treadmill three times a week. You're not gonna do that. You gotta put pressure on that body. You gotta get to the point where you just, I'm about to die. I remember he may be watching it. I've been my spiritual father. Boy, he said, I'm gonna run the 5K. I'm gonna run it. And he ran it. And I was at the finish line with the water. And when he giving it everything he had, putting that body under press, buffeting that body. He came across the finish line. This is how he came across the finish line. And I'm standing there like a servant waiting. Yeah, okay, here he come. He came across, stuck a hand out and just grabbed the ball and said, oh gosh. I said, no, don't bother me. I'm good. What? He had given it all. He had. So when I say get radical and fanatical about thanking God, watch this. Thanking God for the already prosperity in your life and things going well for you, your countenance should be, I serve an awesome God who is not trying to strike me down. He's constantly trying to get the good life in my life. And guess what? Here's what I'm going to do. I don't care if I'm making $100 a month, babysitting right now in between jobs, but I tell you what, I'm going to give 10. Because if our trust in God is dependent on a small tithe, that's backwards. Your trust in God is dependent on whatever proportion you give him. That's what Paul told us. Give based on how God has prospered you. Look at that now. Give based on how God has prospered you. Oh, he's prospered me well, but I'm going to give like he haven't. Man, please. No way. That's a poor mindset. And you know what? They self-engineer themselves and it catches up with us. But God still loves you. You're still going to heaven. You're still going to do that. Okay. Whew, Lord Jesus. One more thing. We're going to the scriptures. In your notes. Don't settle for just enough. Don't settle for just enough. The just enough mentality creates a slave mentality. The children of Israel were freed by Moses, physically speaking. But mentally, they still thought, God, you're not going to take care of us out here. Why? The chains were off their wrist, but it transferred from their wrist to their minds. And they murmured and they complained. And it's like, hey, man, you're out. You're free. You're free. Yeah, but God. You're free, man. Go ahead. Yeah, but God. So when I say change your thinking, it takes work. Okay, let's dive into it here. Psalms 112. Let's go there. We're going to flip through these scriptures. Psalms 112. Mm-hmm.
Just beat him on the head. I don't know about you, but I can just imagine the day where people are just loaded. Just loaded with extra. Come in praising God. No stress. No, none of this. I just see the day. I do. Psalms 112, real quick. We're gonna move through pretty swiftly here. We know, according to Proverbs 13, 22, right, that a good man does what? Leaves what? Amen. To who? Okay, we know that. Psalms 112, verse 5. A good man also shows favor. Psalms 112, verse 5. Shows favor, we're talking about the generous, and lendeth. Watch this. And he will guide his affairs with discretion. So people thought, man, you're in the flesh talking about go ahead and buy the stuff before you give it to the person who may consume it. Before you give it to the cousin who may consume what's supposed to go to the little Johnny. And he said, no, guide your affairs with discretion. But a good man shows favor. And guess what else he does? He lends. He lends. I think I've gotten 2 loans from my dad. 2. And I paid them back. Not because he wanted them. But he's like, hey, I'm Jesse. I got to show you how to do this now. I had to pay them back. I was working brick mason in the summer, carrying blocks, mixing concrete. You know, finally moved up. Got on that line with a little trial, land some bricks, land the line, touring the line, this, that, and the other. Making that money. He said, that Nike camp was $1,200. I paid for that, you know, the first part of the summer. You're going to money stacking up too. He said, here's what I got to teach you. We're not going to go to the bank and get a loan, but just go ahead and repay me before you go back to school. I'm talking every Friday. I had to bring some money in there to him. Why? He lent it to me. But the good man also showed me how to conduct my financial affairs. And I'm so glad he did it for me because without any kind of training in this kind of stuff, we get up and start making money, don't even know what to do with it. I guess I spend it. I guess I go over here and get a nice house. I guess I go over here and get a nice car. But our financial acumen can't stop at acquiring things. It's got to keep going to acquiring assets. And understanding what an asset is and a liability is, it can't just stop at my bills are paid and I'm acquiring stuff. That's not going to cut it. That gets boring. And when money gets boring, I'm telling you, it just has its way with you. Rob Peter, pay Paul, shuffle around, this, that, and the other. Oh, we're going on vacation this week, so we're not going to pay that. Man, come on. You follow me? So a good man, he shows favor and he lends, but he guides his affairs with discretion. In your notes, when we are overworked or overstressed or things aren't going the way we want, we should always remember this. We signed up for this kind of attitude with God, that we were going to live our life in service to others and in service to him. When we're overworked, overstressed, things are not going our way, that's not the time to say, God, I disengage from you. I disengage from your generosity. No, I signed up for this. Come hell or high water, I got a lot of money, I got a little money, guess what? I signed up to distribute your love to others and to distribute it back towards you. That's what I signed up for. So guess what? They took the job. That's okay. Guess what? I lost the contract. That's okay. All I know is, my attitude is, I signed up for this life. I like to be generous when I got a lot. I like to be generous when I don't have much. I signed up for it, and I'm not going to allow mammon to cause me to disengage from being generous towards people, the kingdom, and myself. I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. 1 Corinthians 16. We're here last week. Real quick. Flip over. Go. 1 Corinthians 16. This is Paul. Paul was always dealing with the churches, man. My God. Dealing with churches, spiritual sons, trying to get them to say, hey, man, you know, approach God like this. Posture yourself towards God like this. But here he's dealing with generosity. 1 Corinthians 16, verse 1. Now concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given order to the churches of Galatia, even so do you. Upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store or set aside according to how God has prospered you. So in the Old Testament, it says, hey, it's back here in the law. You got to do this or God's going to curse you. You know, Malachi, this, that, and the other. But over here, Paul goes, okay, we're not going to approach it like that now. What we're going to do is, how good has God been to you? Now we're dealing with your heart and your posture and your trust in him. How good has he been towards you? Man, God's been good to me, man. I got my little kids here. I got my family. We got food on the table. So our daily bread is being met. Yeah, but where's your big car at? In the Lord's Prayer, he told me that he's going to meet my daily needs. My baseline function is intact. Yeah, but ain't you got goals? You got dreams? I got that. I got desires. But he also told me that I'm going to give you those desires. I ain't got to work for those. What? God knows your true desires. Amen. And sometimes you think your true desire is 5 bedrooms in Jacksonville Country Club, and it's not your true desire. Your true desire is, boy, I hope my daughter's a virgin all the way that she gets married, get in church, serve in church, don't ruin her life, go through this man, that man. That's your true desire. And God says, she's 23, she did it. She's about to get married. And then you just get a raise or something like that? Yeah, I got a raise, but I got to save this to make sure the wedding goes well. No. I got the wedding. I got you. But your true desire is standing right in front of you at 23 years old, and I gave you that. So don't look at me and go, where's my car? Where's my house? No, you stated that out your mouth. But I don't look at the outside. I look in your heart. You wanted your baby to serve the Lord with all her heart. That's what you really wanted. Mammy can cause you to talk like that. What you really want is to lessen the collateral damage of your daughter with men, lessen the collateral damage with your son out here in these streets. That's what you really wanted, and I gave it to you. Why? That was your desire in your heart. Don't confuse that with more money and bigger stuff. Don't do that. God knows our true desire. So Paul says, set aside. These words do not imply that only in cases of exceptional prosperity was a man to contribute. But every man was to give out of whatever fruits he had from his labor. $100, $1,000, set aside according to that. Well, my God, I'm single. I got 4 kids, and I don't make what this business guy over here makes with all these contracts. I don't make that. And Paul goes, I understand that. I'm not trying to ask you to raise up to where he is. Set aside according to how God has prospered you. So he equalizes the playing field, and he deals solely with the heart. Okay, let's keep moving. We said in Proverbs 11:24, he that scatters, yet he increases. But then there's a guy who holds on to everything that he's got and earned. But here's what he's holding on to. Whatever he's holding on to and not being generous towards God, the board says he is tending, or it is tending. It what? That mammon that you're trusting is tending to poverty. That means while it's sitting in your bank account, it's tending to going lower. It's trying to figure out how to get you back into the won't you help me mode while you're sitting there trusting it. It's just sitting there. And I'll tell you what, I've been there. I've been there where I'm trusting that thing and the transmission goes out and wipes out the whole little thing and you're back at zero. Got to trust God. It tends to poverty. You should have just put it in heaven's economy and kept on rocking and rolling. We said last week, what does it gain a man? What does it advantage a man if he gains the whole world? Businesses, promotions, ideal jobs, ideal benefits, ideal 401k. And guess what? You lost your soul towards God in the midst of that. You ain't gained nothing. Mammon has pulled you back into his grip. The traits of generous people. Trait number one. Generous people give out of their substance, whether large or small. Whether large or small, generous people will give out of their substance. Whether it's large or whether it's small. Retired, not retired, Social Security, disability check, $20,000 a month, doesn't matter. They're going to give out of their substance, whether it's large or small. We've seen this in Luke 21, where Jesus compares a widow mite to the rich man's gifts. Remember that? Remember when Jesus went and sat by the offering bucket? Let's see what's happening here. And then the widow woman comes up where her mite, which is a Roman coin, is less than a penny. It's a Roman coin, and she puts it in there. Rich man, you know, he's at 20 grand a month. He don't pull back on his tithe. He tithe 200 a month now. But you know what? Let me go ahead and put $1,000 in this thing. Let me go ahead and do that. Jesus said, look, she gave more than he did. Why? She had all of her heart into this. Watch this. And her trust had no other place to go but in me. But this guy gave 200 and kept 19,800 and says, I did a big thing. You ain't do nothing but trust in your mammon. She gave more than you. Why? She trusts me more than you do. So generous people give out of their substance, whether large or small. Number two, generous people are always willing to go beyond their money. Man, I done gave to that church. Now they're talking about help this single mom move. Man, my God, how much do they want from us? Well, I'll go read the story of the Good Samaritan. That's what you need to read. What? The Christians walk right by. Man, you need to exercise, buddy. I don't know what to tell you. Man, here comes a Good Samaritan. Clean you up, put you on your horse, get some money in your pocket, put you in a hotel, get back on track with God. Generous people are always willing to go beyond their gifts and their money. It's a heart for the house. We couldn't wait to get to Hearts for the House yesterday. Why? Because you got to go beyond your money. Generous people will give their time, their efforts. And they don't say, they got it. It'll be okay. No. Man, we was up here hanging pictures and doing this and doing that. And Jim Siebert, Jim Ursus, putting up ceiling tile, and the ladies and the priors cleaning restrooms and all this kind of stuff. Amanda tried to outwork me. And it was like, hey, just step back. I got this thing, Pastor Derek. I said, oh, okay. Go ahead. Man, my forearms are on fire, threading those things on. I said, my God, this. And man, here come the women. You're doing something wrong. Let me. And out of the corner of my eye, I seen Amanda over there on the end. I mean, let me get over here and pull it down for you so you can tuck it under. And man, those forearms on fire. But here's what I observed. You're not generous like that with your time if you're not generous with your money. And let me tell you what else I observed. Her daughters was just as fanatical serving as she was. What does that tell me? The culture in that house is give of yourself as you honor God as well. That's what we all want in our families, amen? Generous people don't give situationally. You know, I've been there. My God. Oh, Lord. What situationally? Man, you don't know my situation, so I got to back off that giving. What are you talking about? I'm just saying, it's back to school. My daughter needs clothes. This, that, and the other. I understand that, but God's going to take care of you. But please don't let JEA bully you into thinking that $50 short. Please don't do that. Pick up the phone, call them, say, hey, let's make arrangements, pay for this $50 on the next bill. But I'm just not going to dishonor God based on my situation. I'm just not going to do it. Will God still take care of you if you don't do it? Yes, he will. You're not cursed? You're not cursed at all. God still loves you. But don't get in the habit of situational giving. Based on my situation, I really can't honor God. No, don't do that. Generous people are not against having a censored nature. I'm sorry. Generous people are so against having a censored nature. C-E-N-S-U-R-E-D, nature, in their house, in their marriage, in their hearts, in their organization. What does that word mean, censored? It means against something. It means to express extreme disapproval of someone or something. And generous people are so against a censored nature-based household. Just look, we're not against giving. We're not against honoring God. We're not against taking care of the poor.
We're not against that. Matter of fact, that's why God gave us Hector. We're going to do it. I'm just saying she needs to get herself in line. And then, well, I don't know what you're saying, but you're speaking out of turn, sweetheart. We're not against that. They're in need, and we're gonna do it for them. Or I'm talking to my wife. Or you're talking to your wife. Or she's talking to her husband. You're talking to your husband. Hey, I feel like we need to do this for them. We don't have a sense of nation in this household. We're not against being generous. Not against them. But I'm just saying, I ain't never seen him speak to you. I don't care. Well, I know what God told me to do. We don't have a censored nature in this marriage. We don't have a censored nature in this household. We don't have that. We're not against giving. We're not against generosity. Generous people don't keep score of their giving. But I tell you who does. What did God tell the centurion? He said, man, your alms, they've come up before my nostrils. When you built that thing, when you, the unsaved man, when you built that thing, God says, that thing has come up before me. Amen. Why? I seen what you was putting in the ground. I seen what you was doing. And the glory of God has come to your house on this day. Amen. Amen. We don't keep our, man, we don't put it on no taxes. We don't, you can put it on your taxes if you want to. I don't, what did they give you, $80 off, something like that? I don't know. But you know, I'm not saying don't do that, but you can do it if you want to. But I don't get upset. I don't think we ever asked world changers for a giving statement. I mean, we just did. I just give it to God. I'm making money. I'm doing good. You know, it's just more stress anyway. Let me standardize this thing. I ain't got 10 kids. I ain't got all this stuff, this, that, and the other. Man, just us four, no more standardized deduction. Give it to me. Let's keep rocking and rolling. Why? I'm trying to get back to earning. I'm not shaming nobody to get the statement from the church. I'm just saying I don't let that stuff stress me out. It just doesn't stress me out. It just doesn't. Generous people have a happy countenance and disposition when it comes to releasing their finances towards God, towards an organization, or towards people. And 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8 says, give with a cheerful heart. Be cheerful towards God. Be cheerful towards that cousin. Cheerful towards that person when you give. Don't be prideful. One of the most powerful forms of gifts is in private. With no hints. Yeah, I did it in secret. You go, man. And you come to church. Was that you? You just get, man, God said, look, if you do it in secret, I'm going to take care of you now. You get your little smirk, a little hint, this, that, and the other. You just got your reward from them. So generous people, they give cheerfully. And I remember being a little baby Christian, this, that, and the other. I said, man, I just got $500. He ain't said nothing to me. He don't know who did this. It's pride forgiving. He don't realize, man, he's rejoicing all this guy, standing up, testifying, and my name ain't coming up. See, what's happening is you're trying to get the glory. And when you give in secret, God should get the glory. So here you go hinting. How's that vacation, boy? You just got your reward right there. Instead of just standing back going, God, look at you, you're good. Let me get out of here before I say something, I'm gone. You know, you give cheerfully, man, knowing that God's going to take care of you, but don't try to get the reward from the person. Look now, there's church on Sunday. You hear me? You hear me, little nephew? There's church on Sunday. Wait a minute now. Hold on now. Now, I know you got to go to school, this, that, and the other, and what me and my wife want to do, and you're just waving that $500. What we want to do, we want to see you in church now. And he goes, wait, let me finish. Let me finish now. We want to see you in church. We want to see you serving God. This, that, and the other. I noticed you're giving your mama trouble, but we want to. He's like, man, for the love of God. See, what you're doing is you're trying to get the credit here. Instead of saying, hey, man, God told me to bless you with that. Hopefully it'll help you with your school, so on and so forth. If you want to know where I got it from, I serve an awesome God. And, man, I'm telling you right now, I love to have you join me at church. If you do, good. If you don't, hey, Unc still love you. We want to see you do good in school. And I'm out of there. Still going. I got to finish this thing. Generous people understand the reward of sowing and reaping. Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6. Whew. Galatians chapter 6. They understand it. They're not just tossing money up into the air.
They understand it, man. Galatians chapter 6. Verse 2. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. Verse 3. For if a man think of himself to be something when he's nothing, he deceives himself. What is Paul saying? Stay low. Don't walk around puffed up. Stay low. God is taking care of you. The only way you are, the only reason you are where you're at is because God has been taking care of you. Stay low. Verse 4. But let every man prove his own work, and then shall he receive, rejoicing in himself alone and not in one another. Watch this. For every man shall bear his own burden. He's dealing with reward here. Let him that is taught in the word communicate to him that teacheth in all good things. I did this with my man of God. But here's what I wanted to get to. Verse 7. Be not deceived. Deceived of what? God is not mocked. Not mocked of what? His system. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Somebody say sowing and reaping. In this lifetime. Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10. Generous people understand the reward of sowing and reaping. They understand it. I used to hide my hand from God, get a little money, back to zero. Hide my hand from God, get a little money, back to zero. I said, man, this is crazy. And what I didn't realize was, Derek, it's just like gravity. You're in this system whether you like it or not. So you might as well put good in the earth. Amen. You might as well put it in the ground and sow to people, sow to God, sow to organization. Why? There's a boomerang effect to it, and you're in it whether you like it or not. I said, man, I might as well be in it the right way. Mark 10, I think it is. Verse 29. And Jesus answered and said, well, first he was telling the disciples, listen, with God, all things are possible. With man, you're going to have limitations, but with God, all things are possible. And Jesus answered and said to the disciples, verily I say unto you, there is no man. He's getting ready to talk about reward now. No man that has left house. See, left house, some people sow a house that they sold, but they left it to come do the kingdom of God like we did. Or brethren, or sisters, or father, or mother. We left our whole families. Her family's from North Carolina. Mine is from Georgia. We left it all. He said, look, I don't forget stuff like that in this lifetime. No man has left a house. Brother, sister. So you can't sit down with your sister every Sunday for Sunday dinner. You can't sit down with your dad every Sunday for Sunday dinner. You can't see your mom every Sunday for Sunday dinner because you left all of that because you felt like God had called you in his place. But guess what? I'm not going to let you down. Or wife, or children, or lands. Watch this. For my sake and the gospel's. But he shall receive a hundredfold. Somebody say now. Yeah. Now when? In this time, not heaven. So to say I'm just going to quesarah, if things are not going your way financially, here's what you do. Back up and track your generosity. Why is it every time I get in tight, nobody comes to my rescue, nobody calls me, won't nobody help me? Here's the thing. Who have you? Why in the world can't this pressure just get off me? I mean, God can take it off of you, but my God. And I tell you what, in between Friday and Monday, if somebody comes along with a $500 check, you ain't got to worry about that car being picked up money. Why? Because somebody in the land believed in God's system, believed in sowing and reaping, amen, and rescued somebody who don't. So he says, in this lifetime, you're going to get your reward. In this lifetime, you're going to get your harvest. You're going to get it. So Derek, you better put it in the ground. You don't look down on folks when they're going through something. You sit here with extra. Don't look down on them now. Why don't you reach out? You got extra. Why? In this lifetime, I'm going to take care of you. Well, my God, I can't spend Thanksgiving with my family. I got to drive 6 hours. She got to drive 7 every single year for Thanksgiving and Christmas. We can't do it. I got your whole family around you. I got people take us in, and we was in an apartment. We ain't have no room to have a dining room table. But guess what? We ate lunch at people's houses. We ate Thanksgiving at people's houses that took us in. Why? No man has left this stuff for his sake, the gospel's sake. I'm telling you right now, God will settle up with the generous. Settle up now. So again, it's like gravity. Man, if I say I can fly and jump off of this thing, I'm going straight to the concrete. Why? Gravity works for all of us in here. Seed time, harvest time is the same way. We can't escape it. But God wants to take care of us in a big way. In a big way. Oh, this is it. We're, after this week, we're headed into some major financial stuff. I'm telling you right now. you just I'm telling you, just get ready. Buckle down. We was in Atlanta, and here's the word that came forth: the church of the middle class church. Yeah. Yeah. We was hanging out that day before Miss Gunn preached this, that, and the other, just kind of talking about it. It was like, hey, that common man stuff, that pathway stuff,
come on,
we're so far ahead of the game. Why? We celebrate choicenaires, not millionaires. Nothing wrong with millionaires, but we celebrate people who have choice financially speaking. Amen. We celebrate people who drive a Honda Accord, who drive a Nissan. Guess what? It's $100 a month, but guess what? I got enough extra to offset the lack of others, enough extra to take care of my future self, enough extra to put away for my grandkids. Where's your big house in Queens Harbor? It's not in Queens Harbor, baby. It's right here in this subdivision. But guess what? I'm rich where I am. Amen. I'm rich where I am. Woo, shake it, jingle that thing. Shucks. Here's what we're going to get into. Here's what we're transitioning into next week. Here's what we're transitioning into next week. And your notes, write this down. Write this down. Common man prosperity. The common folk. We're not looking down on the rich. We're not looking down on nobody. But what we do understand is most churches is 95% middle class. And if you look down on them, you don't let that single mom get that degree. You don't let that guy go to school and up his craft, up his skill to get more income. Guess what you're going to have? You're going to have a bunch of people in your church that's in bondage to increase. They think it's wrong. Lady asked us one time in a session. She said, look, I turned the position down. I said, why? She said, it was $80,000 a year. I said, she said, I don't want to feel like, you know, I didn't. She said, what's your counsel for me? Get your tail. Matter of fact, when you finish this meeting with us, call your boss and say, I'll take that. Don't come here with that false humility. What are you doing? You believe in God for increase and it comes. You want to, I've been humming myself. Ain't no humble. No way. So we're going to parlay into common man prosperity. We're going to get an understanding on what it means to sell time and earn dollars and build a strong, healthy financial life. We're going to get an understanding on what it means to be self-employed versus earning a business, because self-employed, you just employ yourself. God forbid you get hurt. God forbid, you know, something happens. Guess what? You employ yourself, your business may stop. We're going to get into what it means to multiply your business, to replicate your business, to say, you know what? Right now, I make 80%. I'm willing to go down to 65% for another location. Why? What is that? I'm leveraging myself now. Matter of fact, I want to pull out of both of these joints. I'm going to pull out of both of them. I'm going to put on a snow white shirt with some Dockers, some khakis on, and I'm going to be in my F-250 riding around getting contracts and helping other guys make 60 grand a year. That's where I'm headed with this thing. Amen. Yeah, but you're going to take a short. Well, I'll take a short to get my little time back. So I paid myself 10 grand. I go down to 65 just to get my time back and manage two locations. I don't care. Why? Because while I'm managing two, I got my eyes on three. Amen. And I'll be right back up to where I was as self-employed. But now here's the difference. I'm leveraging myself now. Amen. There's a great philosopher who says, you know what? I'd rather have 1% effort from 100 people than 100% effort Amen. Of my own. And most of us, when we get in self-employed, when we get in business, we pride ourselves on it. Man, if I ain't there, I ain't going to get done right. Okay. So you won't train nobody. You won't disciple nobody. And you can't tip folks that's going to help you out. Because sooner or later, you're going to come home and go, man, you are dog tired. What did you make today? $45. $45, man. against her. And that wife starts talking, and all of a sudden it's like, this is not even worth it. So you got to give up more when you're starting to multiply yourself. You got to place a value on leverage. We're going to get into that. We're going to get into what I call the four constants of finances. And you're going to see why average people in this room can stand up and go, what he's saying is in my life. I don't have debt. I got six-figure savings. I don't make 100 grand a year. And my 401k is multiplying. And we got functional cars. No cars with instructions. And we got kids raising a family. All of that kind of stuff. We have that. And guess what? We had that. We was making $30,000 a piece a year. And God has increased us. But guess what? As we increase, our appetite didn't increase. We knew what we were doing. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk... We're going to talk about what does it mean to be choice rich. We're going to create a buzz in this city because we're going to kill the flashy, flamboyant, luxurized debt to pretend. And say, hey, when I open my mouth and say where I am, it's where I am. This $1,000 I got in the bank is legitimate and it's no demand on it. This 10 grand I have in the bank is legitimate. It's no demand on it. Man, you'll feel so empowered to know what? My baseline function. It's taken care of. Now it's time to build something. Now it's time to, after 5 o'clock, from 5 o'clock to 12 o'clock, now it's time for me to get going with some kind of online business, some kind of something. And as I increase, I'm honoring God. But I've mastered my baseline functionality. But here's what we discovered in Pathways. A 100% takeoff. Bills paid on time every 30 days, 30 a month. Boom. One bill paid, $4,000, all my bills are paid on the third. They're still going. Boom, 12 months of liquid in the savings account, emergency fund. They keep going, boom, they're out of debt. But keep going, boom, they're owning a home. And then we say, okay, you're in abundance, let's go to wealth and riches. And they say, whoa. What is that going to require? You got to employ your intellect now. You got to get an investment mindset now. And most people just circle right there and extra. And nothing wrong with it. Just circle right there. Let's circle right there. But here's what I understand. Here's what I've seen. A small percentage. Say, look, I'm looking at the property within the north side. I want this down, that down, such, 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 such. If we go ahead and do this, 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 and this, we can acquire it, pull the equity out of it. About 23 grand, 6 grand to fix it up, this, that, and the other. This turned into a rental property. That's what I want to do. And they do it legitimately. Why? Well, how can they do it legitimately? Everything else is met. They're honoring God. Everything's taken care of, out of debt. But now they're saying, I got to go to wealth and riches. I got to get the generational wealth. And how do I do that? Multiplication. Amen. I got to have a lot of people servicing my debt. That's what a landlord is. What's happening? Somebody's servicing his debt. He's got about 10 of them just servicing. Keep doing it. Man, your 401k is doing terrible. My six properties not. I'm just saying, don't trust in Social Security. I ain't got trust in Social Security. Why? Because when these six babies get paid off, when I hit 65 and all six of them pay it off, somebody servicing their debt, all six of them pay it off, they're worth $2.2 million, but every month they bring in $12,000 a month. Guess what? 12 plus my Social Security, 12 plus my investment, that's my retirement. But guess what? It's coming from dirt. Everything else is a supplement. Why? I had a plan. So when we get extra, we're going to teach you. Okay, you got extra now? Don't pull back from God. Let's leverage yourself now. Why? Because I see your grandkids coming. No, I don't see them. I see them. And they don't want you at the expense of luxury and pretending to take away from their pot and their generation. They don't want you to do that. Well, you're blessed by the word of God. Woo! Yeah. Where's Bobby at? Where's Bobby? Let's go, Bobby. Let's go, Bobby. That's Bob Barrett. He's going to hop on those keys. Let's hop on those keys because it's customary to give God thanks in advance. Thank God for you, Bob. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Hallelujah. Let's lift our hands right now. Glory to God. How many people see themselves out of debt? How many people see those student loans paid off? How many people see themselves funding their generations? How many people see themselves as a real estate investor, business owner? How many people see themselves that way? Go ahead and rejoice. Thank God in advance right now. Woo! Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Woo!
Thank you, Lord. Man, we're always rejoicing because we know God is constant. How constant is God? He's always trying to get good to us. There's always a God working behind the scenes in the midst of chaos. And what he's trying to get us to see is, listen, I only have good for you. And I got you. It's a little pressure. It's okay. Don't leave me. I got you. Amen. Let me get my prayer counselors down front. Glory to God. If you want to be born again, come on. What does that mean? If you want to give your life to Christ, just step out in the aisles and just walk down. That's all it means. As people want to pray with you. If you want to rededicate your life, step into the aisles, walk down, and we're going to help you rededicate your life. What is that? What is rededication? It's just simply saying I want to get closer to God. It's just simply saying I'm tired of religion. I'm tired of saying, hey, I grew up in church. Where's your harvest? Because church, because now, if the guy can halfway preach, he at least told you God loves you. And you should see some fruit from that. So I'm not saying I've been in church all my life. Been in church, I don't even like to hear that no more. All I want to know is, show me God's manifested goodness in your life. And you can do that in 6 months. Or you can be in church all your life and you still don't have nothing. No. So if you want to rededicate your life, come on, man. You want to rededicate your money back to God, come on, man. Why? God is sitting on the other side saying, okay, I'm ready now. I'm ready now. I'm ready to unleash on you like never before. So if you want to rededicate, get born again, come on. If you want to get baptized in the Holy Ghost, in the Holy Spirit, with the evidence of speaking in tongues, that gift is available too. Our church, you click on that tab, we got people sitting aside. We got people that want to pray with you. We got people who want to pray the prayer of salvation with you. We got people who want to help you rededicate your life. Just click on that tab and they'll help you do that. And also, if you want to receive this gift we're talking about, the baptism of the Holy Ghost, guess what? Click on the tab and people want to pray with you. Number four, if God has called you to join his church, grab yourself and come on. One thing I've come to conclude is don't put people in bondage to join your church if they refuse to get to know Jesus. Amen. Put Jesus out first. And you put Jesus out and they get Jesus in your church. They may not join your church for 12 months, but here's what I know. You and Jesus, y'all going to have a pretty good thing going on. And you can remain a serial visitor and just keep coming and keep coming. As long as Jesus is head of your life, guess what? You are welcome in this place if he is or if he's not. But our ultimate goal is to get you to know Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Give it to you four things. The opportunity to get born again, rededicate, receive the gift, and join the church. The rest of us with sensitivity. Oh, now, sister. The rest of us with sensitivity, turn to your left, right, front, and back. Just make sure people are okay. Glory to God. Stretch your hands this way. Father God, we thank you for those who are obedient to your word. And God, we thank you for your word. We declare this word will go in us. We declare this word will yield a harvest. God, you are the Lord of the harvest. And we just declare that the word of God working in the hearts of men and women is under your guidance, God. And boy, this word will sweep the corners of our soul. It will lift us up. Oh, God, it will build us up. And we thank you for it in advance. In Jesus' name, the church said amen. Glory to God. Hold your hand up, Mr. William. You're going to follow that young man right there. He's going to get you what you came down to receive. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Woo! I want you to make it a goal that if you've shamed any Christian out of a church or out of this church or out of God, go repent to them. Why? We're not perfect. We're flawed. They're mad at God because of you. Some kids won't even come to church because their parents are so rough on them. No way. I told my son, I always want you at the Thanksgiving table. I don't care what happens. I don't care what happens. We was talking last night. We said, look, I'm so glad that we have a relationship with our kids that they really believe they can lay anything at our feet. And we won't judge them. I'm so thankful for that because I've seen that ruin people. So if and I just feel led to say that. If you know that you shame somebody. Can't believe you got a divorce. Can't believe you got pregnant while you was single. Can't believe that. Or if you've noticed the onslaught of Christians towards somebody, that's don't rant them out. Go preach the grace of God to them. Let them know they're okay. Let them know God forgives them. Let them know they don't have to walk in church shame, this, that, and the other. Get them under that word. Amen. Woo, repeat after me. Heavenly Father, we declare that we excel in God. Heavenly Father, we declare that we excel in life. Heavenly Father, we declare we excel in all areas of life. Heavenly Father, we declare that you take pleasure in the prosperity of my house, my marriage, my life, my family, my business, my schoolwork. God, we thank you in advance for what you're doing and what you will do in our lives. Go ahead and shout about that. Go ahead and shout about that. Woo! Well, listen, we love you. Angels guard you. Go enjoy your families. We got a couple more weeks before the NFL kicks off. And just enjoy yourselves, amen? Go excel in life. Brother Jim, throw some music on.
He's living on the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. His anointing is empowering. The kingdom of the Lord is within me, and He's calling me to the to our community, show His ability. The will of the Lord for His children is to demonstrate changing. See His glory, feels like heaven on earth. Something's moving, something's changing. See His glory, feels like heaven on earth. Hey!